Absolute Radio.
Where real music matters.
The Jam, a band who inspired a generation, a band who influenced fashion, culture and music, a band who helped create a movement, but a band who were active for just 10 years. This is their story.
The power, the energy that was coming off the stage was something that I'd never experienced, and I've never forgotten it.
As soon as I heard it, I thought, oh, I love this sound, I love that guitar, I love the anger of it, I love the energy of it.
It's really, really important, the bands you listen to and the attitudes you took from those bands.
Paul Weller particularly, you know, was clearly a striking front man.
He has this ability to hear things that others can't hear.
He was almost being framed as a spokesman for the generation, I think, at that point.
The Jam have announced they're breaking up.
Oh, Percy.
Cheers.
This whole band had been taken away from my life. Yeah, it ripped me apart for a while.
He did it so that the band meant something. I mean, I've never heard such twaddle. I thought it was rubbish back in the day, and I still think that's a rubbish excuse.
I'm Phil Daniels, and in this special programme, we look back on the story of mod revival icons, The Jam, from its humble beginnings to its controversial end, and find out exactly why their legacy remains so impressive. This is That's Entertainment, 50 years of The Jam. Shall we start? The Jam are a band etched in British history, with their music being passed down through generations and still regularly heard on radio and TV all around the world. In the next hour, you'll hear from Paul Weller, Bruce Foxton and Rick Buckler, as well as notable fans and those that play a significant part in the band's story. Our story begins 50 years ago in the borough and town of Woking. To find out more, we're going to go back to school with the mod father himself, the Jam's founder and frontman, Paul Weller.
Me and my mate Steve Brooks, I met at school, and we started the Jam in like 1972, when we were both like, I don't know, 14 or whatever we were.
Hi, I'm Steve Brooks. I was co-founder of the Jam with Paul Weller back in 1972. Paul and I met at Shearwater School in Woking, and we realised we both had a bit of an interest in playing guitar, although neither of us could do it at the time. And then when we got together and started learning pretty much together, I'd teach him a couple of things, he'd teach me a couple of things, and that was how it got going, really.
I liked T-Rex and Bowie, Slade, but then I also liked a lot of soul music and a lot of reggae music I heard in the early 70s.
I think probably the earliest, biggest influence would have been the Beatles, but we listened to, because the Beatles also were into a lot of early rock and roll, so we listened to Chuck Berry and Little Richard and try and emulate that, Elvis.
The first time I saw the Beatles on TV, you know, which was November 1963, and I remember it very distinctly, you know, watching them on TV and just thinking it's just the most incredible thing. And so I suppose really from that sort of age, I kind of thought that's really what I'd like to do.
I think the first show we did was in their school music room on lunchtime, and we were both bricking it. When we looked up and saw all the girls there waiting to watch us, we thought, oh, this is a coin of phrase from John Lennon, that's a good show.
With Weller and Brooks starting to make an impression in the music room, the duo decided it was time to take the band out of school. But to do that, they needed some help.
Hi, my name is Rick Buckler. I was the drummer with the Jam from the inset right until the split in 1982. There was a sort of group of musicians at school who used to hang around in the music room. Most of the time, I think people were there to get out of the rain or not wanting to be a stand around in the playground. But anyway, so that's what I think where I first met Paul and Steve. And I knew that they were sort of doing something. I think the first time that Paul approached me was because him and Steve had secured a show at the local Shearwater Youth Club, which is near the Shearwater School. And they needed a drummer. So I said, yeah, I'll do it. I suppose I got the bug for it then.
We With Buckler on board, the Jam sound was already evolving from the Beatles and Chuck Berry covers that had entertained the Shearwater Secondary School music room mere months ago. But the sound was still not complete. Fortunately, a certain Bruce Foxton would soon stumble upon a local newspaper advert.
Hi, I'm Bruce Foxton from the Jam. It was a local newspaper, Working News and Mail. They'd run a little effort and they're looking for a guitarist. So I went along for an audition.
He joined originally with a view to being the rhythm guitar player.
Bruce was told at none uncertain terms that if you wanted to stay in the band, you had to swap from rhythm guitar to bass. Paul couldn't play bass and sing. It's just because Paul was the original bass player. I mean, his real name is John, but he wanted to be called Paul because he's a big fan of Paul McCartney.
So Paul showed me a couple of riffs on the bass. I took the bass, he took the guitar.
With Bruce in, the lineup was complete. And with the help of Paul Weller's dad, John, the Jam began to secure some local gigs and soon took their sound into the dark nightlife of London.
We started off just playing pubs and workingmen's clubs and social clubs.
Our aim, being based in Woking, in Surrey, was to get on that pub circuit.
We could see all these other bands playing there. At the time, it was the London pub rock scene. That's what it was known as.
We'd play a Friday, Saturday, sometimes a Sunday night. That was our schooling, I suppose, you know what I mean? That was our kind of us learning our trade as such, playing to lots of disinterested punters in these places. But, yeah, it was just that was an experience anyway.
And we found that we fitted in quite well because we did a lot of fast rock and roll. The venues would like you to come back if you could fill the places up because they sold more booze.
You could, in London especially, you could go and see a different band every night of the week. There were so many pubs holding live music.
After many months of hauling amps up and down narrow pub staircases, the Jam were growing their sound and starting to make an impression. But they soon hit an unexpected bump in the road when co-founder and guitarist Steve Brooks announced that he was leaving the band.
The age-old question, musical differences. Paul and I kind of grew apart and we'd spent a big formative period, you know, 4 years as a big part of your life age. Paul was had more gone along the sort of mod route, which was inspired really largely by Dr. Feelgood and that whole hard edge sort of R&B image. And then he obviously got into The Who, and I was kind of keener to keep it in the Beatles mode, a more varied kind of, you know, musicological kind of approach to it. Funnily enough, I mean, ironically, I think Style Council was probably more the band I thought the Jam was going to be than the Jam turned out to be.
Steve remains today a successful musician and has worked recently on Paul Weller's solo albums. But for now, his part in the story is over. With his departure, the band swiftly began to advertise for a new guitarist. And despite receiving a number of applicants, the Jam struggled to find a replacement for Steve. Eventually, Paul Weller made the suggestion that the band remain a three-piece. He would take the lead guitar and vocals, Bruce would provide backing vocals and play the bass, and Rick would continue on drums. And the Jam, as we know it, were truly born.
I'm Ian Stone. I'm a comedian, broadcaster, and I wrote To Be Someone, which is a book about growing up in the 70s, part social history, part autobiography, and part love letter to Paul Weller and the Jam. I mean, the first time I heard the Jam was on the John Peel show. My mate, Simon, had mentioned to me about this band, and obviously, you know, I'm a teenage boy. I'd sort of gone, yeah, okay, fair enough. And then John Peel said, okay, this next song is In the City by the Jam, and it just hit me. It just hit me on the side of the head. As soon as I heard it, I thought, oh, I love this sound. I love that guitar. I love the anger of it. I love the energy of it. Also, I was thinking, this is the band that Simon was talking about. This is the Jam. I mean, genuinely, love at first listen.
The Jam fan and musician, Russell Hastings.
My first memory really was my brother took me to the Locarno in Portsmouth. I was 12 actually, it sounds young now, but in those days it wasn't that young to be into music because it just seemed everybody was into music around that time. It's very hard to describe to people what it was like. And I seriously remember the pyros on A-bomb in Wardour Street, and it literally put a shockwave down the side of the building. And I remember the shockwaves moving through some of the drape curtains, you know, and the boom was just unbelievable, which was incredibly exciting to watch. And the sounds, the power, the energy that was coming off the stage was something that I'd never experienced, and I've never forgotten it.
I was 21 years when I wrote this song. I'm 22 now, but I won't be for long.
I'm Billy Bragg. I'm a singer-songwriter, activist, and I'm an old Jam fan. My first memory of Jam would be buying the In The City single when it came out. That was something that really connected with me and my friends, because we had a similar experience to the band in that we were free mates playing, you know, cover songs. What the Jam were doing were quite similar to what we were doing. And interestingly, I don't think I thought of them as being part of the punk rock thing, because they seemed to me to be more connected to early Stones, early Who, and early Small Faces, which coincidentally, me and my mates in the band have been listening to a lot. So that's kind of where our head was at. And the Jam seemed to just come and sit right in that space, except they weren't 10 years older than us. They were our contemporaries. And that's what was special about it, I think. Every time you
need a friend. Our three guests and the Jam are all growing up in a turbulent and challenging time, a time of strife, unrest and political divide. This was Great Britain in the 1970s.
I mean, the 1970s, they were a complicated time. You know, the world was in a bit of a mess. There was industrial unrest. There was a lot of prejudice. There was quite a bit of racism.
Well, there was always a power strike. There was always power cuts, and there was always your bins were never taken out. You always sat in the dark, it seemed, playing games in the nighttime with your mum and dad. And that's people don't believe that nowadays, but they used to just cut the power. You know, there was just so much politically going on. There was so much of a massive divide.
It was a rough old time. Particularly in the mid-70s in London, the National Front were powerful. They came third in the GOC elections in 74. So music then in the 20th century was our only social medium. So it was really, really important, the bands you listened to and the attitudes you took from those bands.
Amongst the growing tensions of the British people and the ever-changing politics of the country, something interesting was happening to the music industry, and something new was brewing. Founder and frontman of the Jam, Paul Weller.
There's a lot of music that was around in the mid-70s. It was a lot of sort of stadium rock and American, generic American rock, and I didn't really relate to any of that stuff, you know.
The music was terrible in the main. I mean, I didn't mind a bit of glam rock, but really, it was hearing New Rose by The Clash and In The City by The Jam. That suddenly turned my head and turned a lot of people's heads.
So push was coming to shove in music, and I think that's out of that a new attitude comes that's a little bit more belligerent, a little bit more, well, you know, the hippies didn't really solve everything or really even address many things, and it's about time we kind of tried to push back.
So this was kind of all leading up to punk happening, really.
As far as the Sex Pistols were concerned, I'd sort of vaguely heard about them before they did the Bill Grundy interview, and there they were. So they were all sat with dinner on our lap, and then Bill Grundy's interviewing the Sex Pistols, and then they started swearing on live TV. Well, it was a very exciting moment for a 13-year-old, and I remember thinking, this is great.
It's what? Nothing, a rude word. Next question. No, what was the rude word? Was it really? Good heaven.
It just changed everything. There was all this awareness around, and I think that those people involved in the Pistols probably don't realise how much an effect it really had.
The Jam's bass player, Bruce Foxton.
Paul himself, I don't know if Rick was there or not, we went to see the Pistols at the 100 Club, and I think it, Paul being obviously the main songwriter, it really gave him a strong direction.
So really, the Jam sound came out of Pistols and Dr. Feelgood, really. When you mix those two together, that's what you have.
The Sex Pistols really, and I hope they don't mind me saying this, were sort of more of a cabaret act, really. The Jam were the real deal, right? The Jam were working class boys. I mean, I know the Sex Pistols were as well, but the Jam were working class boys. And I think the music had more resonance. The lyrics had more resonance. And it's possible that the Jam wouldn't have happened without the Sex Pistols. I think what the Sex Pistols did maybe was opened a door for everyone to sort of barge through.
With a door firmly forced open by the Sex Pistols and the Clash, a new era of music was beginning. An era where anger was expressed. An era where young people were given a sense of belonging. The Jam continued to develop their sound, and their following continued to grow. Show by show, more people were arriving to see this much-talked-about band. And on a misty Christmas night in 1976, one man was heading out to witness Paul, Rick and Bruce for the first time. A man who would change the course of history.
Hi there, I'm Chris Parry. My part of the story starts when I first saw the Jam play at a undercard at the Marquee Club in 1976. I was an A&R manager for Polydor Records. I had been involved with the punk scene from that sort of summer of the same year. Had got close to the Sex Pistols and the Clash. Thought I'd signed them both, actually, for Polydor at various times. But in the end of the day, it didn't happen. And from one of the seriously strong punk followers, one certain Shane McGowan, of all people, said, "Chris, go and see this band at the Marquee. You'll get on well with them." So I did, and that's when it started.
Perhaps a name we didn't expect to play a part in the Jam story. Shane McGowan at the time was frontman of London punk band The Nipple Erectors. The group disbanded in 1981, and the Kent-born musician went on to form The Pogues a year later. But upon his recommendation in 1976, Chris Parry walked through the doors of the Marquee Club and witnessed the much-talked-about Jam for the very first time.
Having talked to Shane a little bit about it, you know, just, you know, he sort of said, look, you know, they're not like the Pistols, and they're not like the Clash. You know, they're coming from a slightly different thing. You know, they're a bit more modish, high energy, but they're really great. When I first saw them, I thought, wow, Suits, that's sharp, you know, that's modish, you know. But what struck me very quickly on the set was the energy level, and Paul Weller particularly, you know, was clearly a striking frontman, you know, quite intense.
So with the vision of Chris Parry, the talent spotting of Shane McGowan, and the early hustle for gigs by John Weller, the Jam became a professional recording band, and Chris Parry became the man who signed the Jam. But there was no time to celebrate. It was time to work. On the 29th of April 1977, the Jam released their debut single, In the City, is 2 minutes and 16 seconds of energy, spikiness and anger, and the first of many Paul Weller youth anthems.
I don't know how many mixes Rick and I did, but I would have thought we'd probably mixed that. It's quite a simple tune, probably mixed it, you know, a dozen times. We just could not get In the City to have that real, yeah, energy, that sort of feeling, you know, something like tension and excitement. And it took a while to get. I seem to think, remember, we put some sort of a pulsed, sort of slight slap echo on it just to give it that liveliness, because it's still... Even today, it sounds pretty fresh and sounds fairly exciting.
Comedian, broadcaster and writer, Ian Stone.
In the City, it's one of the most overtly political songs I've ever heard. It's about police brutality. We all knew it was going on. We'd all read the stories. But for someone who wasn't much older than that, singing about that subject, that was almost a political awakening for me. It made me realise how important this stuff was. That guitar, that jangly guitar. I can hear it now. I can actually hear it now.
Singer-songwriter Billy Bragg.
There was something really sharp about it. You know, it kind of sounded like the Jam looked, you know what I mean? And what's that line in it? You better listen now, you've said your bit. That's such a great line. And it's, there were so many of us who were, because I'm the same age as Paul, who were that coming of age at that time, we're putting up with, you know, working in offices with geezers who thought they knew everything, that last bit of the generation went through the war, who were always telling us that we never had it so good. So yeah, that's the line that always leaks out to me.
In the City entered the UK charts at number 40 and captured the attention and imaginations of a new generation of music fans. Coming up after the break, we'll take a look at the important role that fashion and style played in the Jam story.
And the rumour's true, little pair. Are you the new pop?
Okay, okay. At this point in time, we can neither confirm nor deny anything. Apart from Christmas, that is, with a range of gin liqueurs from $8.99 and champagne from $13.99. Because Lidl is big on a Christmas you can believe in. Subject to availability excludes NI.
Oh, why is this not working?
There's a bit of a trick to the flush. Do you need a hand?
Bathroom causing you a little house embarrassment? Let Wickes create your dream bathroom from design to installation. And now there's up to 20% off bathroom products from the showroom range. Cure your house embarrassment with Wickes. For more information and to book your free design appointment, visit wickes.co.uk.
It's the most wonderful time of the year.
Free airport lounge access with 4 and 5 star holidays with On the Beach. See terms and conditions, outbound only, subject to availability, atoll protected.
On the beach.
At Kia, we believe to find inspiration, you have to move. Our Kia Inspire event features exclusive offers on selected models like the Kia Exceed, Sportage, Stonic and Picanto. Get your first two services free, 7.9% APR representative and up to £2,500 PCP deposit contribution. Plus, these models will be available sooner than you think. Search Kia Inspire event.
Kia. Movement that inspires.
T's and C's apply. Petrol models only. Kia Finance ends 28th of February.
Have you ever been caught out by payments you've forgotten about? Join over 2.5 million customers who are already using the Lloyds Bank upcoming payments tool on our app. It gives you early sight of regular payments that are due to leave your account in the next 31 days to avoid any surprises. It's just one of our many useful tools that can help you stay on top of your money. To find out more, go to lloydsbank.com/cost of living. Lloyds Bank. By your side.
Text Gold want to help you start the new year with a bang and get cash for your new, old and even your broken gold, silver, platinum and palladium. And here's how. Request our fully insured selling pack now. Put the items in you want to sell and post them back to us. We receive them, value them and make you an offer on the same day. If you say yes, the cash is in your bank within 24 hours. To start, text Gold to 66777 or visit textgold.co.uk.
So, show us your holiday picks.
Absolutely. That's just our new kitchen. It's from Wickes. More new kitchen, more new kitchen. Gorgeous worktop. There's the island. That's our new wine cooler. I think I deleted all our holiday snaps.
Why be house embarrassed when you can be house proud? At Wickes, there's up to 50% off showroom kitchen units. To book your free design appointment, visit wickes.co.uk.
If you shop at Sainsbury's and you don't use the Smart Shop app, then I'm afraid you've been a bit of a silly...
Sausage. Ooh, 50p off.
That's right. You get personalised Nectar prices based on the things you actually buy. And it helps you stay on budget because you can track your spend as you shop. So don't be a donut. Next time you shop at Sainsbury's, use your...
Melon.
Download the Smart Shop app.
My Nectar prices available in store and with Smart Shop only. Personalised discounts and points vary per customer. Exclusions apply. For full T's and C's, visit smartshop.sainsbury's.co.uk.
Win £250,000.
End the year on a high with £250,000 tax-free.
Listen out for details.
Absolute Radio.
Welcome back to That's Entertainment. 50 years of the Jam with me, Phil Daniels. Another way the band were making an impression was through their choice of clothing. Although not its originators, the Jam are instrumental in bringing the mod style back into the British mainstream. But what is mod? And where did this iconic style journey begin for the band? The Jam's bassist, Bruce Foxton.
Well, I mean, it started off with John, Paul's dad and the Jam's manager, trying to get gigs, basically, around Woking. And it was a lot easier for John to show photographs of these respectable lads wearing suits, you know, not ripped-up jeans and safety pins or whatever.
The Jam's drummer, Rick Butler.
There was a lot of bands during the 70s who looked as if they just rolled in from the streets. They didn't make any effort at all to present themselves on stage in any shape or form. They look boring. We're going to have our own identity. That if you saw a photograph of us, you think, well, I don't know quite who these are, but they look like the Jam. That's the sort of thing that we were after gaining, really, was our own identity on all facets. And I think we did achieve that.
Russell Hastings.
That whole mod look, that thing from the Small Faces through to early Who stuff, haircuts, smart clothing. Yeah, the whole Quadrophenia thing. You know, if you're ever curious about it, go and watch the movie Quadrophenia. But it was just that whole movement. And Paul was so fixed on it, you know, and I, you know, took my hat off to him because he stuck with it all the way through. And it was just what he believed in. And I guess that's great. If you go with something that you believe, whether people like that or not, that's entirely up to you. But I think it changed that whole movement. You know, that movement came about really because of the Jam. You know, it came about the second time, the second wave of it. It was called the Mod Revival. I sort of hated that word, really, because everything's sick, you know, circular. When you went to see them, you broke your neck to see what they were wearing and when they ran out on stage. That's what carried the band forward. And that's what separated really from that pop, that punk movement, you know.
Billy Bragg.
The whole mod style thing has always been something that reconnects with the English. I mean, the English don't have their own national costume. If they did, I think it would be the mod would be the English national costume, you know, but it's sort of like Italian shirt, American jeans, Tony Curtis haircut. It would, you know, it kind of sums up to me in many things about the eclectic nature of being English.
Comedian and Jam fan, Ian Stone.
There was a place down Carnaby Street, or just off Carnaby Street, called the Carnaby Cavern, I think it was, the Tailors. And we trooped off down Carnaby Street. I couldn't afford a suit. My mates got suits made up. I think they were 65 quid. And then he had these Jam shoes as well. They were Jam shoes. They were sort of winkle picker type shoes, pointed at the end with white on the top and then black all around. But really, I think, I mean, Paul's a mod, right? I mean, he is the mod father. And so it's trying to look as sharp as you can. I think that's one of the things about a genuine working class band. They wanted to look smart. I'm definitely not as into fashion as Paul Weller. I'm not sure there's anyone on earth who's into as fashion as much as Paul Weller. I mean, I've had chatted to Paul about his fashion sense, and he's talked about outfits he had when he was 7 and 8, and he could describe them in great detail. I can't do that, right? Oh yeah, I had a romper suit when I was 2. I loved it. So it's nothing like that. But yeah, you want to look sharp. If you don't have a lot of money, you know, you're almost like wearing your Sunday best, you know, and that's how they were turned out. And I love that about them.
I was with Paul one afternoon, and he said to me, have a look at these photographs. Who do you think that is? And I went, well, it's you guys. You know, he went, no, it's a Small Faces on the Ready Steady Go show. And there was 9 photographs, and he gave 3 to me, 3 to another friend, and 3 to another friend. So I've still got those photographs, and I can't tell you how much it looks like the Jam. You can see where Paul got that from. You know, the whole, where he's emulating that whole posture, what you'd stand with the guitar, you know, that whole haircut look, that whole thing, you know. And it was just carried off so well, you know, and it was just an iconic look.
By the end of 1977, the Jam were rapidly rising in popularity, and many young adults were heading out on a Friday night in their tailored suits and Jam shoes. There were many people who were pivotal in the early success of the Jam, but one who perhaps stands out above them all, maybe even rivaling the band members themselves, is their manager. There are many music managers etched in history, and most prove to be unique, interesting, and sometimes controversial characters. The Beatles had Brian Epstein, Sex Pistols had Malcolm McLaren, The Jam had Paul's dad, John Weller.
20 minutes to The Jam. And you can call me all the names you like, but they won't come on before. And I'd like to remind you about The Doors once again.
When you read any of the books that have been written about the Jam, and there have been quite a number, John Weller is front centre in all of them. He made it happen. He hustled for gigs in the early days. He drove them around. You know, he was working. He had a day job, but in the evening, that's what he did, because he knew his son had some talent and he knew the band had some talent. And so he basically did the hard graft that you have to do. And the first time that I saw the Jam, the last person I saw before they came on, John Weller walked out in front of the audience and went,
"Put your hands together for the best band in the world, the Jam!"
I didn't actually know at that point that that was Paul's dad, but he was crucial. He was crucial. I think that without John Weller, we don't know about the Jam. We don't know about Paul Weller.
Drummer of the Jam, Rick Buckler.
He obviously was a big help to us. We couldn't afford a van, so he would borrow one from somebody. We used to play a little club in Woking called Michael's, and there was a guy there who owned a Lioness. So he kept it in the back of a Luton van. So we decided that we would borrow this van off him. So the guy said, yeah, you can borrow the van, but you'd have to take the Lioness with you. And I remember we played a little venue. Some guy said, "I'll give you a hand out with the equipment." So we're carrying this big speaker cabinet, rolled up the shutter of the back of this Luton van. There's this Lioness just sitting there staring. I mean, if you're looking in the eyes of a lion, they look fairly serious. The guy just dropped this cabinet and ran. But yeah, John would borrow the vans and from wherever we could find them. I think when we signed to Polydor, they were quite concerned about John's knowledge of the music industry. So we said, we're not signing unless John stays as the manager.
John Weller himself, on his role in the band.
Well, obviously everybody knows this, my son, Paul. He was like playing guitar since the day one. And when we got to around about 12, 14, he was writing songs. Melodies, slow mo kind of melodies, and he had a talent, obviously, an obvious talent for music. So I said, "Well, I'll push you. I can't give him an education. I can't give him money. So I'll give him what I can. Give him inspiration, shall we say that, or push, whatever a father can do."
And then the way that he treated the fans, he got us tickets for a gig in Paris. We didn't have any tickets, and we saw him outside the gig, and he said, "You're right, lads." And we said, "Oh, we haven't got tickets later." And he went, "Here's some tickets," and he gave us some tickets. What other father of a major musician would ever do that? I genuinely can't thank him enough.
John sadly passed away in 2009, but his character brought a smile to so many people, and his role in the story cannot be emphasized enough. One of the firm reasons behind the Jam's long success was Paul Weller's incredible songwriting. Amongst the anger and political themes, he also wrote beautifully relatable lyrics that resonated with so many people, which has led to him being revered as one of Britain's greatest lyricists.
Hi, I'm Dan Jennings, and I host the Paul Weller fan podcast, Desperately Seeking Paul. It's definitely come through on the podcast, talking to many guests, that Paul is clearly hugely well-respected as a musician, as a singer, and most of all as a songwriter. I think people like broadcasting legends like John Wilson, who can recite lyrics to songs like Private Hell by The Jam off the top of his head, and they take him right back there to those moments in the late 70s, early 80s. He's there in the crowd once again. Clearly hugely inspirational, but also he has this ability to hear things that others can't hear, things that aren't there, a brushstroke of sound that's just needed to layer up and finish a song that other people just don't hear things that way. And he has this incredible ability to paint pictures. So many of his standout songs have lyrics that take you somewhere.
Singer and activist, Billy Bragg.
The vignettes in Paul's songs are things that you've experienced. The images he's using are not the cinematic over the horizon stuff that Bruce Springsteen uses. They're things that you will have personally experienced or have knowledge of. And I think that's what grounds his music in our experience as well.
Stepping away from Paul Weller, the songwriter, comedian and author Ian Stone recalls a story from one night in Brighton, which gives us some insight into Paul Weller, the person.
It was as close as I ever got to a religious experience, to be honest with you. We went down to Brighton to see The Jam. We'd all seen Quadrophenia. The whole thing felt right. So we'd go down to Brighton, go and see him in the Brighton Centre. And then and it was a brilliant trip down for, I think, four of us who went down. And then after the gig, rather than go back to the B&B, we thought, right, what we'll do is we'll go down to the Grand Hotel on the seafront at Brighton. We went down there. We were a little bit shocked at the prices in the bar. At some point, the concierge decided we weren't really suitable guests for the Brighton Grand Hotel bar. And he asked us to leave. And we sort of grumpily went, okay. As we were leaving, Paul Wellack was coming in the other way. We obviously fell on him. Yeah, oh, Paul, oh, we're being thrown out. And Paul, bless him, looked at the concierge and said, these lads are with us. These lads are with us, with the band. And they invited us back into the bar. And we sat a respectful distance away from Paul and the band while they're having a drink. I don't think we even actually talked to him again. But it was the fact that he said that. And you know what? In a small way, he meant it as well. We were with the band because the Jam, they cared a lot about their fans.
To be someone must be a wonderful thing.
In 1979, the political landscape in the UK was changing. And on the 4th of May, Margaret Thatcher was elected as the new Prime Minister. The Jam would respond to this news less than a year later with one of their most famous songs.
Her Majesty, the Queen, has asked me to form a new administration, and I have accepted. It is, of course, the greatest honour that can come to any citizen in a democracy. I know full well the responsibilities that await me as I enter the door of number 10.
From the Jam frontman and lifelong Jam fan, Russell Hastings.
Going underground, the production on that is just phenomenal. Such a fantastic insight. And I clearly remember it, probably four or five of us running through the school corridors into the lunchtime dinner hall, celebrating that it had gone straight in at number one.
Do you know what? The first thing about Going Underground is it's such a brilliant song. It's an utterly, utterly brilliant song. The lyrics are great. It was about Thatcher's Britain, though. That's what it felt like. It was about Thatcher's Britain.
Singer and activist, Billy Bragg.
You're hearing Paul's first steps of political expression there. Beyond just, you know, the world's messed up and I'm really angry about it. When you get to Going Underground, he's like, it's an issue-based song. And that was encouraging that punk had thrown away a lot of the detritus from the hippies and the 60s, but they've maintained that notion that although music can't change the world, it can make you feel like the world can be changed, you know, that sort of thing. And I was glad to hear that.
Manic Street Preachers bass player Nicky Wire, who lists Going Underground as one of his favourite songs.
But I think with Going Underground, Paul is, there are a lot of stuff on there. I think it's one of his most amazing lyrics, and he's written such brilliant words, but it's almost like he's hiding that there's so much flashing in his head and Going Underground, you know, flying ships on the TV screen, this boy shout, this boy scream. I just want to hide away, because he was almost being framed as a spokesman for the generation, I think, at that point.
Going Underground debuted at number one, becoming the band's first chart-topping single. Despite its success, Going Underground was not included on the Jam's next album, Sound Effects. Released in November 1980, Sound Effects proudly boasts the endorsement of Paul Weller himself, who claims it's the group's best album. The frontman has also spoken on the album's influences, stating it was heavily inspired by the Beatles' legendary 1966 record, Revolver. As well as providing the world with the bassline heavy start and the social commentary, Man in the Corner Shop, the most notable song from this album is this show's namesake, That's Entertainment. Ian Stone.
Yeah, That's Entertainment. It's a great song, partly because it's different from a lot of the other stuff. It's the acoustic guitar. The imagery, again, is amazing. It is poetry. I've heard it said, actually, that Paul Weller, his lyrics, introduced a lot of people to poetry. And I think That's Entertainment really is poetry.
Billy Bragg.
It's like it's not just the 70s as seen by a late teenager. It's the 70s as seen by a late teenager who's ever so slightly tripping. And suddenly these really everyday, ordinary things have taken on a deep philosophical meaning. The harmonies are really, really important because it implies you're not the only person who's seeing this. Your mates are seeing it too. And that's one of the great things I love about the Jam is Bruce Foxton's harmonies.
Russell Hastings.
It's just one of the most clever songs, beautiful songs going. It describes everybody's childhood. And it means so much to so many people, you know. Two lovers kissing amongst the scream of midnight. Two lovers missing the tranquility of solitude.
There's no way you should be able to fit that into a song. Forget it. I'm a songwriter, let me tell you. There's no way. You know, that's a kind of, that's a caught into a pint pot of a line.
and he pulls it off. The audacity of that, it kind of makes people like me brave. If Paul can do that, it's possible to do that. Is it possible to do that? Yeah, it is. He's done it, and it's moved me.
Two lovers kissing makes the scream of midnight. Two lovers missing the tranquility of solitude.
I had a funny experience with Paul in That's Entertainment when he first heard me play Levi Stubbs Tears in a sound check. And afterwards, he said to me, is that Levi Stubbs and the Four Tops? Yeah, it is, Paul. He looked at me and said, I thought you were supposed to be a folk singer. And I said, well, it's kind of soul folk, Paul, you know. He said, you want to show me how to play that then? And I said, yeah, if you show me how to play That's Entertainment. And he sort of was like, he like a spat, you know, That's Entertainment. And I'm like, what? He said, one of the greatest songs to come out of that period is, he said, I wrote it in 10 minutes, he said. The demo's much better, he said. The demo's loads better. So years later, I heard the demo. Sounding like to me, it sounded like the Birds.
In a 2011 interview with Absolute Radio's Sarah Champion, Paul Weller addressed the claims that he wrote the song in a matter of minutes after a drunken night out.
Yeah, I did. I wrote it really quickly, yeah. But it was, you know, it's one of those sort of songs that's kind of easy to write, really, because I was just sort of drawing on everything that was around me, immediately around me, you know. So it was kind of wrote itself.
But that story is true, then? You had a few, and you were sort of in
there. Yeah, yeah.
That's true. You wrote an amazing. If I'm bad, if you have a kebab and have a little lie down, but you wrote That's Entertainment.
Well, you know, it's one of them songs that to be written really, without sounding too dramatic about it. They kind of sometimes, not all songs, but every now and again, they just kind of write themselves in a way. You're just a kind of conduit to release the ideas. You know,
the thing that most annoys all about it is he just knocked it off in 10 minutes when he was drunk. So Leonardo, how did you paint the Mona Lisa? Well, I came home from the pub one night. I'd seen this bird and I was like, whoa, you know, and in the morning, you know, it's kind of, I think that's his problem. The rest of us were just like, oh, wow.
You're listening to That's Entertainment, 50 Years of the Jam, a special program marking 50 years since the Jam were founded. I'm Phil Daniels, and coming up after the break, we'll turn our attention to the darker side of the band's journey, the controversial breakup in 1982.
Jason Manford, Absolute Radio.
With Disney Plus.
In 1956, Harper Lee's friend gave her a full year's salary as a Christmas gift so she could take time off to focus on writing. She used the time to write To Kill a Mockingbird, which has now sold more than 40 million copies. I reckon I could probably write To Kill a Mockingbird.
Well, yeah, I don't just want a screenshot of notes going, it's a fella and he's got like magic powers. I haven't worked it out yet, but That's all I've got so far.
Function of 50 grand.
I don't want that.
Jason Manford.
Sunday mornings from 8 with Disney Plus. This festive season, get a variety of must-see entertainment for all the family on Disney Plus. Entertaining everyone this Christmas.
Why is this not working?
There's a bit of a trick to the flush. Do you need a hand?
Bathroom causing you a little house embarrassment? Let Wix create your dream bathroom from design to installation. And now there's up to 20% off bathroom products from the showroom range. Cure your house embarrassment with Wix. For more information and to book your free design appointment, visit wix.co.uk.
Everyone's got an extra doppelganger, someone that looks like you.
I even shop like you.
And we both know how to make the most of our shopping. The Nectar card.
No, the Nectar app.
Eh? With Nectar, you can collect and spend points at Argos and Sainsbury's.
But with the app, there's also personalised discounts and bonus points on products you buy most at Sainsbury's.
But...
plus hundreds of brands to discover and collect points at, like eBay, Esso and Just Eat.
What?
Nectar. Get the app, get more. Personalised discounts require smart shop exclusions. Apply for full T's and C's. Visit nectar.com/app-terms.
If you're someone who's proud to say they found a great deal, then tell your friends that you got 50% off your fully built units, 40% off your quartz worktop, 15% off installation, and up to 5 years interest-free credit, plus a whole load of other great deals in the Wren Kitchen's best ever sale. If you'd rather people thought you paid a luxury price for your new luxury kitchen, well, we won't tell them if you don't. The Wren best ever sale now on. Offers apply when you buy 5 or more units, subject to status and minimum spend.
Hi, Nick Knowles here. These days we're all concerned with the rising price of energy and how to be more sustainable. But the team at Euronix have got some great solutions. Like, did you know you could save up to 38% more energy using eco programs on your washing machine? With brands like Beko, Blomberg and Hotpoint. And with over 600 Euronix stores nationwide, you can just pop in or give them a call. For great local service... just ask.
Euronics.
It's the most wonderful time of the year.
Free airport lounge access with 4 and 5 star holidays with On the Beach. See terms and conditions outbound only, subject to availability, atoll protected.
On the beach.
Nice work. 3 presents wrapped. 4 if you count both slippers. So, probably time you unwrap something for yourself. Like the Big Tasty or the Big Tasty with Bacon. Now at McDonald's. Well, it's Christmas after all. Until the 14th of February 2023. Subject to availability. Served after 11 a.m.
And the rumour's true, little bear. Are you the new boss?
Okay. At this point in time, we can neither confirm nor deny anything. Apart from Christmas, that is. With a range of gin liqueurs from $8.99 and champagne from $13.99. Because Lidl is big on a Christmas you can believe in. Subject to availability, excludes NI.
The home base sale is now on. So if you're looking to refresh or transform your home, look no further. With great offers on everything you'll need, from kitchens and bathrooms to furniture and storage, plus much more. But hurry, the sale must end soon. Find out more at homebase.co.uk.
You're listening to Absolute Radio.
Welcome back to That's Entertainment, 50 Years of the Jam, with me, Phil Daniels. The band's final album, The Gift, released in 1982, is notable for its difference in sound, as Paul Weller started to experiment with his love of Northern Soul and R&B music. It included one of the Jam's finest singles and perhaps one of the greatest pieces of music of the time, A Town Called Malice. Comedian, broadcaster and writer, Ian Stone.
Obviously, you can't deny that it's one of the greatest pop songs of all time. It's just so tuneful. It sounds like it could have been written yesterday. It's got everything you'd want in a pop song. I genuinely think it's a work of genius. The poetry in it is fantastic. Rows and rows of disused milk floats that died in the dairy yard. I mean, my God, where does that sort of stuff come from?
The Jam fan and musician, Russell Hastings.
It rings through to so many people, Town Called Malice. It is one of those songs that will be around for many, many years, and it's just one of those songs that don't come around that often.
Singer-songwriter Billy Bragg.
A Town Called Malice is kind of the summation of it all, isn't it, really? It has the political anger, but also the velocity. Like a great Motown song. He finally worked out how a kid from Woking could sound like The Temptations. And then what does he put on it? He puts this righteous anger, you know, this kind of like spitting nails attack on Thatcher's Britain.
The Jam's drummer, Rick Butler.
I love the song. I think it's fantastic, but it does get played to death. I mean, it's blatantly obvious that it's a Motown feel. And Phil Collins did exactly the same thing with Can't Hurry Love around the same time, if I remember rightly. It's a great feel. We'd obviously cut our teeth on doing a lot of these cover versions in our very early days. So the musical side of it seemed quite easy, really, to sort of put this together. And I think we did a pretty good job on that one.
Less than 9 months after the release of The Gift, with the band at the top of their game, Paul Weller made a decision that would send shockwaves through the country. The following news report was heard on October the 30th, 1982, on BBC's nationwide programme.
The Jam have announced they're breaking up. The group are led by singer and songwriter Paul Weller. At 24, he's become something of a spokesman for the new beat generation. We went to meet Mr. Weller just before he finally unjammed the Jam.
It is amazingly successful. Why stop now? Because I feel we've achieved enough, you know. I think we've done all we can do as the three of us. I think it's a good time to finish it. I don't want to drag it on and go on for, like, you know, for the next 20 years doing it and become nothing, mean nothing, end up like all the rest of the groups, you know. I want this to count for something. I want everything I've done, you know, the last 5-6 years to count for something.
The news was true. The Jam had reached an abrupt and heartbreaking end, leaving thousands of adoring fans in shock.
I was in the lounge at my mum and dad's house, and my dad was leaning on the floor. He used to read the newspaper on a Sunday on the floor, and he said to me, "Oh, it says the Jam has written up there." I went, "What?" And I got down on the floor with him, and I read the little article. It said that the Jam were going to be splitting up, and I didn't believe it.
And then, of course, there was no social media around at the time to prove otherwise. Yeah, it ripped me apart for a while.
I couldn't quite believe it, to be honest with you. Why would you break up? What, we all still love you. What are you doing? And I was gutted. Of course I was. But I was gutted really for myself more than anything, because I suddenly realised, oh, I'm going to have to find a way on my own now. Paul had sort of guided me into adulthood. Now it was up to me. And I think there was partly fear there as well.
I mean, I have to say, I think there's a logic in what Paul did with the Jam, much as it was heartbreaking for those of us who loved them. Because there they are now, pristine in that time. It's a bit like the Beatles. They stand alone. And there's nothing worse than a band where the main creative forces got bored. You know, Paul never got to that place. He never gets to that place. He moves on. He remains true to himself. Whatever it was he believed about the Jam didn't fit into those great big arenas. So what do? You either just get drunk every night and carry on doing it and go and live in Weybridge or move to Los Angeles and go like Rod Stewart, or you pull the plug and go and do something else. More power to him.
As well as a stunned fan base, many thought of Paul's friends and band members, Bruce Foxton and Rick Buckler, who had gone from being part of the biggest band in the country to being unemployed overnight.
What about the other two? Your future career does at least look fairly played out. What about them? Some people are saying, aren't you dumping them? Well, it's a lot of crap, isn't it? You know what I mean? It's a group. We work together as a group, you know. It's not my responsibility, you know.
Are they happy about the breakup?
Also happy about it, no.
Bruce Foxton.
He called and meet him and said, look, you know, I want to leave the band.
Oh, but I think, cheers.
Rick Buckler.
Paul came out sort of pushed almost by John. And John was saying, well, look, you've got something to say. And it was almost like Paul didn't really want to come out and say it. You know what I mean? He was sort of constantly being prompted by John. And we were given this reason that Paul felt that he was on a treadmill and that he wanted to get off. To this day, I still think there was something else going on with Paul that he wasn't happy about, that he just simply gave us this cover story and, quite unkindly, I think, gave to the Jam audience this cover story that he did it so that the band meant something. Now, I've never heard such twaddle. I thought it was rubbish back in the day, and I still think that's a rubbish excuse.
I'd have preferred if he'd have taken a break, but that was his decision, and, you know, you've got to respect it. And, yeah, you know, life moves on.
With the decision made and no U-turn from Paul in sight, the Jam hosted a run of farewell shows across the country, culminating at the Brighton Conference Centre on the 11th of December.
It was tough to do those last shows in London. Very emotional time, because I felt that we still had more to offer musically.
I mean, I remember looking at the faces of the people in the audience, and that's exactly how I felt, that this was just odd, that this was all finishing. You know, you could see it on their faces that they did not want this to happen, in the same way that I did not want this to happen.
The Jam fan and musician, Russell Hastings.
I went to one of the Wembley shows. They added on the very last night at Brighton, which was pretty much near my hometown. So I remember being at the very last show as well, and then coming out and sitting on the steps of the Metropole Hotel. When the doorman asked me to move, and what they said was, excuse me, son, you're going to have to move away from the door now. And I went, but you don't know what's just happened to me. This whole band had been taken away from my life, you know. And there I was the next day. Oddly enough, it can sound quite sad, really, but with no direction, really. No allegiance, no nothing to follow anymore, nothing to sort of go with, because it was how you got your look. It was how you understood what music was coming out. It was everything. It was like you'd been abandoned.
Comedian and Jam fan, Ian Stone.
You've got to let go, haven't you? Sometimes if somebody says they don't want to see you anymore, you just go, oh, okay.
I haven't spoken to Paul since 1983, which is crazy. I think it's just because he knows that he can't look us in the eye over a lot of things.
As the doors closed on the Brighton Conference Centre and the final mod departed into the night, the Jam were no more. Paul Weller, Bruce Foxton and Rick Buckler would never share the stage as a trio ever again. But our story doesn't quite end there. As many years later, a chance encounter between Rick Buckler and the Jam-loving musician Russell Hastings would begin a new chapter in our tale.
This is the modern world. This is the modern world.
Russell Hastings.
myself and Rick met Rick Buckner, the drummer of the Jam, met in a radio station back in around 2000, something like that, 1999.
And I started chatting to him, and I was more interested in the fact that he could do double glazing, because I needed double glazing on my house. And he did me a great deal. And then when he came down and did it, I remember standing in my office looking through a hole in the wall when Russell's outside beginning to fit the double glazing units for us. And we talked about, you know, the Jam music and all the tribute bands and that sort of thing. And so we sort of formulated this idea, well, why don't we just take it out on the road just for me to revisit the Jam songs, which was absolutely fabulous.
The band was called The Gift at the time, and then about a year down the line, Bruce was on the same bill with a band called the Casbah Club. And we all ended up at the same gig, and Bruce said, why don't I jump up and do a couple of tunes? So Bruce jumped up and did, with Rick and myself, did Smithers Jones and Down the Tube Station at Midnight. And the place went bonkers.
The Jam's bassist, Bruce Foxton.
It was a real buzz. You know, I hadn't been on stage with Rick for like 18 years or whatever it was at the time. And the audience were in tears, literally grown men crying. And I thought, well, they're crying because it's bad. But it wasn't that long after that I fancied doing some more shows with them.
And then we couldn't get rid of him. You know, it was like he loved it so much. So we decided then that we'd change the name to From the Jam.
The demand, you know, even though it's two-thirds of the Jam, I think, you know, people just thought, well, that's probably the best I'm going to get.
We go out there, do we recapture the sound? I don't know what that's all about, how to do that, but we play those songs as to how we remember them being played.
As I said earlier on, you couldn't replace Paul, but we didn't intend that with Russell, because he probably brings a style of his own to the tape, with his own take on how those songs should be. It's kind of quite a unique story, really, isn't it? That he's a fan down the front, and now he's at the front.
Thank you very much indeed. On drums, Mr. Rick Buckler. On bass guitar, Mr. Bruce Foxton.
Rick left the band in 2009 and has since released several books on his time in the band, including his latest, named 1982, which was released last month. Bruce Foxton is still performing with Russell Hastings in From the Jam, giving those kids from the 70s a chance to hear those songs once again, while also allowing a new generation to hear them live for the first time. Meanwhile, Paul Weller continues to further establish his place among the songwriting greats, having enjoyed success with the Style Council in the 80s and an impressive solo career since. I'm Phil Daniels, and thank you for joining me for this look back on the story of one of the most influential bands in British music history. The story of the Jam started in those school music rooms 50 years ago with Paul Weller and Steve Brooks, but it has transcended generations, with their beautifully crafted songs being passed down from parent to child like a precious family heirloom. Those songs sound as good today as they did during their inception and continue to put a smile on people's faces. And that is entertainment.
Smash a glass and a rubble of boots, an electric train and a rip top.